أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين I seek refuge with Allah from Satan the accursed in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. All praise is due to Almighty God Allah, and may the prayers and the peace be upon Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him and upon his family and his companions altogether. Ameen. Welcome to Islam in Focus. My name is Saifuddin Hassan, and I'm just one of the many Muslims in the greater New Haven era making an attempt to bring about a better understanding of Islam. Islam, what is Islam? Islam is an Arabic word derived from the Arabic roots of Silm and Salam. These terms mean peace, purity, submission, and obedience. As a way of life, Islam calls for complete submission to the will of Almighty God, Allah. Muslims are those who freely and willingly accept the supreme power of Almighty God, Allah, and strive to organize their lives in accordance with the teachings of Allah. Mohammedanism is a misnomer to Islam and offends the very spirit of Islam. Islam was not founded by Muhammad, and Muhammad is not the founder of Islam. Islam is not a new religion, but is the same message which Almighty God Allah revealed from time to time to all of His servants and messengers. Allah has said in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Say, we believe in Allah, and that which was revealed to us, and that which was revealed to Abraham, Ismail, Isaac, Jacob, and the tribes, and that which was revealed to Moses and Jesus, and to all the prophets from their Lord. We make no distinction between one and another of them, and we bow our wills to Allah in Islam. Once again, welcome to Islam in Focus. Today, by the praise and glory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have on our show Brother Hamza Abdul Malik. Brother Hamza Abdul Malik is a retired businessman who reverted to Islam in the year 1970. He regards himself as a humble student of Islam and of comparative religion. Brother Abdul Malik has had 23 years and has studied the comparative religion with special interest in the New Testament theology and Christology, the theological study of the person and deeds of Jesus. He has engaged in Christian-Muslim dialogues and debates in many cities and universities in the United States and Canada. In 1985, he attended a missionary training course in Durban, South Africa, and was co-instructor. Many of his lectures and debates are available on video. His book, titled The Mission of Jesus, to Whom He Was Sent, is also available. Brother Abdul Malik is presently the director of the Islamic Research and Propagation Center in Queens, New York, where he teaches comparative religion. Before we go to Brother Abdul Malik, we would just like to say that we had opened the invitation up to many preachers, Christian preachers, scholars, whatever, but they declined the invitation to come on our show today. So we would like everyone who is listening, who is Christian, to get out their Bibles, because we know Brother Hamza Abdul Malik has a lot of information. So we ask you all to please be ready. God willing, he will give a lot of information to you in regards to the Bible. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Abdul Malik.
Alhamdulillah,
welcome to Islam in Focus. To get us started, I would just first like to ask you, is the Bible the authentic word of Allah, God, without error as it now stands today?
Okay, I thank you for your question, and I thank you for having me here, and it's my pleasure to be here. When we talk about the Bible, is it the authentic word of God, unadulterated, without human involvement? We have to, first of all, question what version of the Bible are we inquiring about? Of the many versions, if you can pan your camera here on this table, you'll see that there are several, at least a dozen versions of the Bible here. The King James Version, the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, the Reims Catholic Douay Version of the Bible, one version after the other. So we're talking about what version of the Bible are we trying to find the soundness of. not only are we talking about versions, but we're talking about translations as well. We want to inquire, is the translations of the Bible, are they inspired by God? So in order to do that, I have prepared an outline that will take us through several steps in order to reach a understanding of your question. And that is, we want to talk about the term Bible itself. Where does this term derive from? We want to talk about the term authenticity, and we want to see if the Bible meets that criteria. We want to talk about inerrancy. This is another term that we have to investigate. We want to talk about the term inspired. Is the Bible the inspired Word of God? And finally, we'll try to conclude by talking about the term Word of God itself, because the Bible teaches that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So it's very important that we understand what, in fact, is the Word of God. So I'll begin by talking about the definition of the term Bible. And the term Bible is derived from a Greek word, biblos, which means books or little books. So when we inquire about the Bible, we have to inquire about every single book of the Bible. In the Catholic Bible, we have 73 books. In the Protestant Bible, there's 66 books. So we have to verify each book. We can't talk about the Bible as a whole. We have to verify each book. The book of Deuteronomy, the book of Numbers, Revelations, the book of Mark, or whatever. We have to discuss all of those books. So the first thing we want to discuss is the term authenticity. Authenticity. The word authenticity means to have a genuine original. When you have something that is authentic, you have a genuine original. And the best way to certify if the Bible is in fact a genuine original would be by looking at the manuscripts. The oldest manuscript that we have concerning the Bible is what is known as the Syriac or Aramaic manuscript, which I'm displaying a copy of that now. This manuscript dates back to the year 400 of the Christian era. So as a result of that, we have no original manuscript there. The oldest Hebrew manuscript of the Bible in existence dates back to the year 1000 of the Christian era. Therefore, we have in those two sets of manuscripts no handwritten autographed originals. Of the New Testament, the oldest manuscript in existence out of the five major, what is known as codexes, is the Codex Sinaiticus and the Codex Vaticanus. And there we have no genuine originals. These manuscripts date back no further than the year 400. So in terms of having authentic book, an authentic book in the Bible, we have no genuine original manuscripts. And so therefore, it will not stand up as being authentic if we look at that source. If we look in terms of the word inerrant, or inerrancy, and to find out if the Bible is in fact inerrant, what does that term mean? Inerrancy of the Bible means to be immune from all possibility of error. And so we find in the Gospel according to John, chapter 10, verse 35, there Jesus says that the Scripture cannot be broken. That means there's no contradictions possible in the Scripture. If in fact it is the Word of God, there will be no contradictions there. Now, just to prove that that is not the case with the Bible, we only have to look at the text of Mark chapter 1, verse 2. And any of our Christian brethren who are viewing us today, if you have a Bible, you can turn or jot down at least these texts and look at them later. Mark chapter 1, verse 2, where there it is written, it says there, "As it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare the way before thee." Now here Mark makes an error in the text of his writing there, in the Greek text. This is not an error in translation. If you look at the Greek text, which Brother Hassan, you can check here. I have it here. And if my viewing audience can at least see a title on this here, a scripture here, you'll see the Greek text there. And in this Greek text, the term is according to the prophet Isaiah. So what happened here? If you look in the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, what I just quoted to you was from the King James Version. If you look at the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, which I have one here, in that same text of Mark chapter 1, verse 2, it says there, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. If you look at the Douay-Rheims Version of the Bible, the Catholic Bible translation of the Bible, there it says, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. And finally, if you look in the Revised Version 1881 of the Bible, there it says, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. So why would the King James Version of the Bible have this translation as it is written in the prophets? We say because the King James Version of the Bible, those editors of the Bible there, was seeking, in my view, to camouflage this error that is intact there now in the text. The translators of the King James Version, 1611, seeking to camouflage this error, have translated Mark 1:2 to read as it is written in the prophets instead of as it is written in the prophet Isaiah, when this prophecy came from Malachi. Malachi chapter 3, verse 1. So therefore, we see that inerrancy cannot stand the test. What about inspired? Inspiration is a Latin term that means breathed into. And our Christian brethren want to tell us that the Bible is the Word of God breathed into through inspiration those writers, those holy people who wrote those scriptures 2,000 some odd years ago. And unlike Judaism and Christianity, our Christian brethren have chosen to use the term inspiration as opposed to the term revelation. And perhaps we'll touch on the difference in that. There's a big difference in those two terms. Where does this term inspiration of the Bible come from? It comes from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. And there it says, Paul is saying there, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for your doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. So Paul is affirming that all scripture is inspired by God. And Peter, in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, points out the nature of such inspiration when he says, the holy men of God spoke inspired by the Holy Ghost. So our Christian brethren tell us that they have now certification that the Bible is, in fact, the inerrant, inspired Word of God based on these two primary biblical texts. But when we examine these texts, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, in this verse, the term scripture refers only to the Hebrew scriptures. None of the early Christian writings were recognized as holy scriptures until about the year 2000 CE, meaning Christian era. When Jesus and the New Testament authors referred to the scriptures as the writings, they always meant the Jewish scriptures. The all scriptures referred to by Paul in 2 Timothy 3:16, therefore, of course, meant Hebrew scriptures. So even if this passage proved inspiration or not, infallibility or not, it would only be certifying the Hebrew scriptures. There was no New Testament writings in vogue at the time. Now, the Revised Standard Version, or the Revised Version, which I have a copy of it here, the Revised Version of the Bible, 1881, has translated that verse in 2 Timothy 3:16, where King James says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, has translated that verse to mean every scripture inspired by God is also profitable for. Therefore, these translators acknowledge the fact that in some scripture there's a possibility of it not being inspired by God, just in the basic interpretation of that verse. Not all scripture, but every scripture. Now, to talk about this concept of the authenticity of the Bible is not something new. It's not something that we as Muslims are bringing up as an issue to prod our Christian brethren. This concept has been in vogue and was stated by one Jeremiah the prophet in Jeremiah chapter 8 verse 8. And he stood and he was able to say to his contemporaries without any fear of contradiction that Jeremiah chapter 8 verse 8, quoting now from the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, and most of my quotations will be from the King James Version of the Bible unless I state otherwise. Now I'm quoting because it's more clearer what's being said. The Revised Standard Version of the Bible. There Jeremiah says to his contemporaries, speaking about the authenticity of the Bible, how can you say that we are wise and the law of the Lord is with us? This term, law of the Lord, means Torah. How can you say that we are wise and the law of the Lord is with us when behold the false pen of the scribes have made it into a lie? And we are told, as Brother Hassan recited to you a verse from the Quran at the opening of our talk, woe then to those who write the book with their own hands and say that it is from Allah. So Jeremiah is certifying and backing up this statement of the Quran that those people who receive the oral transmission of the Torah, don't forget that revelation from God was received through prophets orally and eventually reduced to writing. So Jeremiah is chiding his contemporaries that you who have received this revelation from God, when you begin to write things down, you begin to have your infightings and your different schools of thought, they come into play and whatever, and now you have polluted the Word of God. And we'll touch on this a little more in a few minutes. Now, to give you an example of something from one of the gospel writers themselves to certify this topic of inspiration of God and that the Bible itself is not inspired by God as a whole, we only have to look at the gospel writer's statement, Luke. In Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, in his opening statements there, he himself tells us and all of the world today that he is not writing his gospel on the divine inspiration. What does he say in Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4? He says there, for as much as many have taken into hand to set forth in order and a declaration of those things which are surely believed among us, even they as delivered them unto us, which from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word, it seemed good to me also, having had perfect understanding of all things from the very first, to write unto thee in order, most excellent Theophilus, that thou mightest know for certainty those things wherein thou hast been instructed. So here we have Luke making no claim to be divinely inspired. He says that it seemed good to him since many people had been doing that before him. And since he says many, we ask our Christian brethren, where are those many accounts? We only have before Luke the gospel according to Mark, the gospel according to Matthew. Where are those other many gospels? Perhaps the gospel according to James and Barnabas and others. They are not now long lost. Now we know that Luke is able to speak about inspiration because we only have to look in Acts chapter 15 verse 28 and contrast that statement that he gives us there with the statement that he just gave us in Luke chapter 1, verse 1 through 4. In Acts chapter 15, verse 28, there he says, it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to embark on this undertaking that he was doing. It seemed good to us and to the Holy Ghost. So this fact becomes clear now that he is not claiming inspiration in his gospel according to Luke. His qualifications are simply that he has been compiling things that had been handed down to him from eyewitnesses whom he claimed were eyewitnesses to these facts. Second, third-hand information. So therefore, we can see that one writer, at least, is not claiming inspiration. Now, when we talk about the Word of God, We have to discuss, is there any such thing as a divine test that can determine the Word of God? We don't want to take upon ourselves such an awesome responsibility to determine of our own intellectual capacity what is in fact the Word of God. We would ask, does the Scripture itself give us a methodology in order to reach this end? Now, the test that the Quran gives, I'll just say as Muslims, we have, as one knows, most people know, the Holy Quran is our divinely revealed scripture. And there we are given a test in the Quran to tell us that if this is the word of God or not. And there it says, أَوْذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ أَفَلَا يَتَتَبَرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ إِنْدِ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Will they then not meditate upon the Quran? And if it were from any other than Allah, any other than God, surely they would find therein contradictions. So this is the Quranic test. We are not going to seek to impose this test at the moment anyway. On the Bible. I think we should investigate the Bible itself and see if the Bible gives such a test. I think that would be
absolutely
fair. The Bible gives such a test. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 20 through 22, there we are told, in verse 20, the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak. This is God speaking. Or shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. And this other gods to the Jews could imply a Trinitarian concept of God, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. This is a strange God to the Jews. Anyone who would speak and prophesy in that name would surely fail. Verse 21 says, and if thou say in thy heart, how shall we know the word of the Lord, or the word which the Lord has not spoken? When a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, we are told, if that thing follows not nor comes to pass, that is the thing which the Lord has not spoken, but the prophet himself has spoken it presumptuously, we shall not, or thou shalt not be afraid of him. So we can see now that the test here is that prophecies, we're given a test of divine prophecies being fulfilled or not. If a prophet, first of all, comes and speaks in the name of a strange deity, or if a prophet speaks something and that thing prophesies and that thing fails or comes not to pass, we should not worry about that person or that prophet. That would in fact be false prophecy. So let's investigate the Bible itself to see if there's any such thing occurring in the Bible. Does it hold up consistently with prophecies, predictions, and so forth? What about this prophecy made by Jesus, allegedly, peace be upon him, in Matthew chapter 10, verse 23? There we're told that Jesus, having sent his apostles out, his 12 chosen handpicked disciples, on their first great commission is called. Their first and the only commission that he sent them on. He never sent them only just this one time. Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 and 6, he says, go not into the way of the Gentiles or any city of the Samaritans, enter ye not, but go ye rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And in verse 10:23 of the Matthew, he says there, but when they persecute you in this city, flee ye into another. For verily I say unto you, ye shall not have gone over all the cities of Israel till the Son of Man become, or has come, return. So here we have a prophecy put into the mouth of Jesus, peace be upon him, that his apostles are to go out and they are to preach that the kingdom of God is at hand and that the imminent return of Christ, as it's called, is so near at hand that they would not have been able to go over these cities of Israel, more or less the whole world, as we're told in Matthew 28:19. That they're not able to go over just the cities of Israel there until this event, this final day of reckoning is upon them. Now, this prediction is about the imminent coming of the Son of Man, Jesus tells his apostles in plain words that he does not expect to see them back in the present age. The arrival of the Son of Man will take place before they shall complete a hasty journey through Jerusalem. Now, no promise throughout the whole of the scripture is, on the one hand, more definitely expressed, and on the other, has turned out more flagrantly false than this, which yet forms one of the main pillars of Christianity, the second coming of Christ. 2,000 years has passed. The apostles, we know, have gone out on that mission and have come back, and this prophecy failed. How can we tell? Jesus says in Matthew, when talking to his apostles, preparing them for an imminent danger now, some conflict is arising, and he's gotten news perhaps that there's some band seeking to capture him and perhaps persecute him and put him to death. So he says there in Matthew chapter 10, verse 16, "Behold," Jesus says, "I sent you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves." Verse 17, he says, "But beware of men, for they will deliver you up to council, and they will scourge you, and in the synagogues, and they shall you shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake, and a testimony against the Gentiles. But when they deliver you up, take not no thought for how or what ye shall speak, for it shall be given to you in that hour what ye shall speak. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. And brother," he goes on to say in verse 21, "and brother shall be delivered up unto brother to be put to death, and the father and the child, and the children shall raise up against their parents and cause them to be put to death, and ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved." We're here to say now that these predictions recorded in Matthew chapter 10, verse 16 through 22, of the suffering and trials of his apostles being put to death and one thing after the other, never occurred and failed. There was no outpouring of the Spirit. This prediction failed. There was no second coming of the Son of Man. This prediction failed also. And the apostles returned safely and soundly, as recorded in Luke chapter 22, verse 35. Now, again, we find that Jesus, according to these gospel writers here, is making another prediction that it seems to have failed.
About another 15 minutes now. Yeah.
Jesus is reported to have proclaimed again and again, in very short time, the existing world as we know it would end. So soon indeed would this great reward be realized. Jesus assured his followers that, "Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all things be fulfilled." And to be more specific, Mark records Jesus is saying, "Verily I say unto you, there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste of death till they see the kingdom of God come with power." Meaning those of his contemporaries. Some of you who are standing right here, who hear my voice, will not die. You will be living, and you will see the Son of Man coming, and you will see this kingdom of God being established. We say that that prediction has failed, that those people who heard those words have long, 2,000 years or so, died. Now, when we talk about the Quran, where the Quran has said that woe to those who write the book with their own hands and say that it is from God, we're talking about alterations spoken of in the text of the scripture, as well as being made for some personal gain. Now, we have a Bible scholar, Christian biblical scholar. His name is Reverend J.R. DeMello. And he has said in his book, a one-volume commentary of the Bible, on page 26, he says, "In the legislative portions of the Bible, of these books, we find apparent contradictions, and these not in minor or insignificant details, but in fundamental enactments. The text of the New Testament," he goes on to say, "to begin with, the writers of the gospel report in Greek the sayings of Jesus, who for the most part spoke Aramaic." So therefore, he is affirming also what the Quran has said in terms of the text of the scripture being faulty. Now, there's a Catholic scholar. His name is Professor Hans Kung, and he has written a book entitled Infallibility. And on page 216 and 217, he points out something very interesting. He says there, concerning the Bible and concerning the Quran, he says, hence it is not a question here of a miracle, for an instance, with the Quran, which was directly revealed from heaven by angels to the prophet as a sacred book. Before taking up the Bible, he says, we do not have to wash our hands. Nowhere do the books of the New Testament claim to have fallen directly from heaven. Rather, they do often enough insist quite frankly on their human sources, such as in Luke chapter 1, verse 2. He concludes by saying, the operation of the Spirit excludes neither defects, if you talk about all scripture given by inspiration of God and the Holy Spirit being involved there. He says that the operation of the Spirit excludes neither defects nor faults, excludes neither concealment nor dilution, neither limitations nor error. Now, when we talk about the King James Version of the Bible, we look in the Revised Standard Version of the Bible here. This is the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, a revision of the Revised Version, 1681. And there they speak about the King James Version. After giving some glowing terms and statements about the King James Version, they said the King James Version, with good reason, has been termed the most noblest monument of English-speaking prose. He goes on to say, yet the King James Version of the Bible, has grave defects. By the middle of the 19th century, the development of biblical studies and the discovery of many manuscripts more ancient than those upon which the King James Version was based made it manifest that these defects are so many and so serious as to call for a revision of the English translation. He goes on to say, sometimes it is evident that the text has suffered in transmission, but none of the versions which we have here provide a satisfactory restoration. And finally, he says, the King James Version of the New Testament was based on a Greek text that was marred by mistakes, containing the accumulated errors of 14 centuries of manuscript copying. So much for the King James Version of the Bible.
Wow.
Now, that's easy to make that statement, and you might say, well, if that's so, what are some of these grave defects? And our Jehovah Witness brethren has published a booklet entitled, Is the Bible the Word of God? And there in this booklet on page 82, they asked a question, speaking about Bible contradiction, biblical contradictions. They say, some people will answer, does the Bible contradict itself? They'll say, no. Is the Bible the Word of God? No. They say that the Bible contradicts itself. Perhaps you have heard some say, they say this. But think back to the incident. They want you to reflect for a minute. Did the person making the claim actually open a Bible and show you an example? Usually those who say that the Bible contradicts itself makes no attempt to prove it. They really know of no proof. They are simply parroting what they have heard others say. So I guess our Jehovah Witness brethren would like for us to open a Bible and actually show them a contradiction. Perhaps that would be sufficient for them. I don't know what the purpose for them asking that. But the King James Version has said, the Revised Standard Version, rather, has said that the King James Version has grave defects, so many and so serious. What are some of those grave defects? Number one, John chapter 3, verse 16. Many people see in sporting affairs, you see somebody in the bleachers, they're holding up a sign that says John 3:16 on bumper stickers. That scripture there says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now, the first question, was Jesus God's only begotten Son? The answer is no, according to 1 Samuel 16:13 and Psalms 1:7. About David, we read in Samuel 16:13, David, peace be upon him. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him, David, in the midst of his brethren, and the Spirit of the Lord came down upon David from that day onward. In Psalm chapter 1, verse 7, David is speaking. He says, "The Lord has said unto me, Thou," meaning you, "art my son, this day have I begotten thee." So we see from this scripture that David is a begotten son of God, according to that scripture. In Mark chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized with John in the Jordan. And straightway, coming up out of the water, he saw the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying the same thing that was basically said to David, "Thou art my son, the beloved, in whom I am well pleased." So this has come to be known by some, including the Apostle Paul, as the adoptionist theory, because we know that Paul did not believe in the virgin birth of Jesus. In Romans chapter 1, verse 3, he says, concerning our Lord Jesus Christ, who was born of the seed of David according to the flesh. In verse 4, he says, and was declared to be the Son of God by power, with power, by a resurrection from the dead. He never taught the Trinity. He never taught virgin birth. He held adoptionist theology. So many say that this Gospel of Mark, this statement there about Jesus being baptized and being declared to be the Son of God at that moment was an adoptionist theology. So now we find that in the Revised Standard Version of the Bible and most modern translations of the Bible, the word begotten is now removed. There's no more terms such as begotten Son of God. And Allah has told us in the Quran, "Lam yalid wa lam yulad." He begets not, nor is he begotten. So our Christian brethren have finally corrected that error, but it remains in the King James Version of the Bible as a grave defect. What is another grave defect, according to the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, which is based on the most ancient manuscripts? Biblical manuscripts are never dated as original manuscripts. They're always dated as ancient and most ancient. So the Revised Standard Version of the Bible bases its authenticity on the most ancient manuscripts, never on original manuscripts. And there in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, we are told that the King James Version of the Bible has that verse there as a grave defect. There it says, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Now, the literal translation of that verse, if we look into the Jewish Bible, the Jewish translation of the Bible, and I have one here, which is entitled the Holy Scripture, based on the Masoretic text, they translate that text there as, "Behold, a maiden or a young woman shall be with child." They have it there, "Lakin yitan Adonai hu lakin uthenna ha alma hara vi yelda ben vikuri shimi Emmanuel." There, al-harat alma is the term, and the term that's been used in the King James Version of the Bible, which was translated from a Greek version, which I have here, a Greek version of the Old Testament, which was prepared for the Jews who had scattered themselves in the diaspora, it's called, and had lost their Greek, their Hebrew tongue, and so that therefore they had to have their Bible translated for them in Greek. And so therefore, since the New Testament writers was using a Greek text, they thought best to use the Greek version of the Old Testament to translate Isaiah. And in doing so, they made a grave mistake because they translated the word there, virgin, as parthenos, where we get the term parthenogenesis from, instead of the term alma, which would mean virgin proper, young woman. If the Jewish people had wanted to use the term virgin proper, they would have used the Hebrew term Bethula and not alma, So we see there that there's another grave defect in that situation. And finally, I'll talk about one more grave defect, which I think we should mention, the Trinity. 1 John chapter 5, verse 7, the Trinity. A grave defect according to the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, which is based on the most ancient manuscripts. 1 John chapter 5, verse 7 says, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit," or the Holy Ghost, "and these three are one." Now, according to Mark, Jesus never taught this concept of Trinity. And we just stated that the sign of a false prophet would be that one would speak in the name of a strange God. And Jesus was asked, peace be upon him, in Mark chapter 12, verse 29, by a scribe, asked him, "Master, which is the greatest commandment of all? Which one is that is so solid and so sound that all of the rest would rest on that one?" And Jesus, not thinking of something from himself, but quoted the Shema from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, where it says there, "Shema Yisrael Adonai Elohino Adonai Echad." "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." Pretty much like we as Muslims say, "Kul hu Allahu Ahad." Ihad and Ahad means pretty much the same thing. It excludes any concept of Trinity, dualism, pantheism, whatever. So now we have seen that there are basic problems with these versions of the Bible as we now have them, these translations and versions. According to the Revised Standard Version of the Bible, which is based on the most authentic sources, the earliest sources, the sources that are closer to the time of Jesus, peace be upon him, the King James Version and other versions have grave defects. And I'll stop at this point and give our brother Hassan a chance to give some thoughts on what we just said.
Jazakallah khair, brother. We just want to make an announcement that this is a live show. We're doing the program live today. If anyone is interested in calling in, the number here is 562-1898. So, as I said, we're doing a live show, so we ask all our viewers to please call in, and you can ask any question that you would like to our brother Hamza Abdul Malik, because God willing, he will be able to answer any of these questions for you. Once again, the topic today is the Bible the authentic word of God? And we have had Brother Hamza Abdul Malik speak on this topic. And I think we have a telephone call, and we're going to go to that call. Yes, hello, you're on the air.
Yes. I understand all the things you're going through by pointing out this, that, and the other about the grave defects and all of that. Now, my question is, what are the things that are that bear witness, and that's what's going to help us get out of this condition that we're in, instead of pointing out wrong, you know, say, what's the right? So, because we need the right, that's what's going to help us, not the wrong. I mean, even though that you pointed it out, we can see it now. Now, what is right so we can go forward?
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much for your question. Brother Hamza, would you like to answer that?
Please? Yes, I would. Thank you very much for that question also, and it's a very good question. We're told in the Bible, and when we talk about these defects and contradictions and one thing in the Bible as Muslims, we do not believe that the Bible as a whole is not the Word of God. We are taught as to believe in the previous revelations, as our brother Hassan also reported from the Quran, that we believe in the Torah and the Injils and the scriptures given from various prophets. However, we don't believe that these versions and these translations that we have today are intact the Word of God. But what is intact, we affirm. And we affirm the position in Genesis chapter 17, where it says there, Moses is, Abraham has been given certification from God, talking about his son Ishmael. As for Ishmael, Genesis chapter 17, around verse 20 and 21, "As for Ishmael, behold, I have heard them. I will bless him and make him a great nation." God is telling Abraham about his son Ishmael, who we know the descendants are the Arabs, where we have the prophet of Islam, Muhammad, who brought the Quran to mankind. We ask our Christian brethren simply, how was that particular a promise of God fulfilled, to bless Ishmael and make him great? We say it was through the descendancy of Ishmael, the prophet of Islam, Muhammad. My point to get to the brother's question is this. In the book of Deuteronomy, we are told in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 18, Moses is prophesying the coming of someone who would do just that, who would guide you into truth, who would give you the final revelation from God. He says there that God has told him, I will raise you up a prophet. I will raise them, the children of Israel, up a prophet like unto me, like myself, like Moses. And I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto you all that he's commanded. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 18 and 19. And God warns us there that it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. We say that these words spoken in the name of God, that if people do not hearken to, is the word of the Quran, which we profess to be a divine revelation, not inspiration from God, put into the mouth of the prophet. And to back that statement up, Jesus himself, which we accept this text, in the Gospel according to John, chapter 16, verses 12, 13, and 14, when he's about to depart from his disciples, to answer the brother's question again, there Jesus is telling his disciples, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. You're not ready for them now. Howbeit, it will come to pass that when he, this person is called the Spirit of Truth, he will have such an amount of truth with him that he is the embodiment of truth himself. When he, the Spirit of Truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. How's he going to do that, you might ask? It says, for he shall not speak of himself by inspiration from God, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, direct revelation from God. And he will show you things to come. He will take of mine and show it to you. The things that I have taught you, the basic fundamental things like Tawheed or the unity of God, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one, he will take that because everything that belongs to one prophet in that sense belongs to the other, and he will show it unto you. So, my brother, the question to answer your question is that we have the Quran here now for 1,400 years. The religion of Islam is not a new religion. It's the continuation of what has been given and the perfection of what has been given to all the prophets from the inception of man.
Okay. We have another phone call. We're going to go to that. Once again, the number here, 562-1898, and you're listening to Islam in Focus, and today our show is the Bible, the authentic word of God. We're going to go to our call. Hello, you're on the air.
Yes, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I was listening to your show, and earlier he was in his comments on the Bible and the errors that he thought lied therein. One of them had said that the tribes of Israel, when the apostles were told to go to the lost tribes of Israel, those tribes were actually scattered to the north reaches up into Britain, Denmark. Proof of this is the particular tribe of Dan, as it went along its way, conquered many tribes, other tribes indigenous to the area, hence the name Danube. When you get to Denmark, and there's all little cities and towns around there with the name of that. I think the localized version that he just told us about as far as the apostles going there and getting like shunned away from, I think is on the false side there. I think it's more far-reaching as far as what he was talking about in that particular verse.
Okay.
You have any comment on that?
Certainly do.
Okay, we'd like to thank you for your call. We're just going to hang up. You're welcome.
The verse itself says in Matthew chapter 10, verse 23. First of all, in Matthew chapter 10, verse 5 and 6, Jesus cautions his disciples. First of all, he says in Matthew chapter 15, verse 24 about his own mission, that it was limited, that he says, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. This is who he sent to. And when he commissioned his disciples, he said, go not into the way of the Gentiles. That means anyone who's not an Israelite. Or any city of the Samaritans enter ye not. And these people were Jews, but they were into polytheism and one thing after the other. They were not true to the Torah. So he said, don't even bother with them. If he's not going to bother with them, he's not going to bother with Gentiles. If he's not going to bother with Jews, right, half Jews, he certainly got time for Gentiles. He'd rather go to them first. He says, but go ye rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And then in verse 23, Matthew 10, 23, which I quoted, he says, you will not have gone over all the cities of Israel until he's returned. Regardless of where they were scattered, he said, you would not have even gotten over Israel until I'm returned. And this is my point.
Alhamdulillah. We have another call. I hope that answered our caller's question. We're going to go again to our telephone call. You're listening to Islam in Focus. You're on the air.
Yes. quick ones. The first one is, who is the Mahdi? And the second one is, who was the one who came to the black man in America speaking our tongue? As the Quran says, that we shall not send you a prophet other than raise one up of your own. So who was raised up in America for the black man who was in this 400 years of slavery? Thank you.
Oh, brother, would you like to...
Apparently, the brother's picking up this language and this terminology from Minister Louis Farrakhan and his speech at the Myanmar March and things of that nature. When you talk about the Mahdi, Mahdi just means a guided one, one who's guided. And this terminology is used in Islam in various senses. In one sense, it means that Muslims believe that every so often, say 100 years or whatever, there will come someone who will reform Islam, a Mujaddid or Mahdi or whatever, to bring Islam back on the track, not to bring any new guidance or anything, just as a reformer. This person could be anyone. And there's many other explanations about this term. When you talk about who was sent to the black man in America, we're not limited. Islam is not limited to the black man in America or anywhere in the world. Islam and the Prophet of Islam was sent to the whole of mankind. Allah says in the Quran, surely Muhammad is a messenger to the whole of mankind, and that the Quran is a revelation to the whole of mankind. So African nations are basically Muslim nations. These are the black nations. They're basically Muslim nations. And Islam is the religion of all mankind and of all the prophets for all time.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you, brother. Just to add to that, as the brother said, that the Prophet Muhammad was sent as a messenger to all humanity. He was sent as rahmatul lil alameen, the mercy to the world. So the verse that the young man is quoting, that the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, there will be no prophet after him. So this was talking about before. Allah sent messengers, but he sent them all before Muhammad. He is Khatan al-Nabiyyin. He is the seal, the last of prophethood. So there's no one going to come to the black man, anyone else after Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace be on him. He is the last to come, and we see that all these people who come, these false prophets, quote from either the Quran or some other source because they can't make up the word of Almighty God. So understand what this verse is talking about. Read the Quran, and you will get what this means. We have another telephone call. We're going to go to that. You're listening to Islam in Focus. You're on the air.
Yes. First of all, let me compliment you. You refer to Christian and Jews as brothers. And I think it's a representation of Islam that's consistent with what I know about Islam, that it's a message of peace and love. And would you comment on the anti-Semitic orientation that some misrepresentations of Islam have sort of brought to fore?
Okay, thank you very much.
I don't know if I understood the feeling of his question.
I think he was basically asking some of the things that have happened, the anti-Islamic propaganda and things that are going on against Islam, you know, that we refer to everyone else as brethren, but when it comes to the way people deal with Muslims, that it doesn't seem that they treat us in the same manner.
Why don't you go and deal with that? I think you're doing fine.
Inshallah. Basically, as Muslims, especially, we are a people of tolerance. And in the word that is used in the Arabic is bir, that it is something that is basically the way you treat your parents. That is a very strong word. And even the Jews and the Christians are referred to in the Quran as Ahli Kitab, the people of the book. So this is a respectful term, that these people were given revelation, but unfortunately, as the brother has talked about, they forgot the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They changed the word. But we recognize them as receiving, you know, revelation before. And as we are here today, we are trying to guide these people back to the truth, get them to embrace the message of Islam, which was the same message that Jesus brought, that Moses brought, that Allah doesn't have all these different variations, that Allah is one. And this is the basic thing that Allah wanted us to come to, was the concept of tawheed, to believe in the one God. Okay, everything else is after that. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one. Keep the commandments. And I always like to quote that one verse that Jesus said when a disciple came running to him, good master, what may I do to obtain eternal life? He said, why callest thou me good? There is only one who is good, and that is God. But if thou wish to obtain eternal life, keep the commandments. So this is a basic, fundamental speech of Tawheed, the oneness of God. Jesus is eradicating anyone even saying he is good. He is saying there's only one who is good, that is God. So we as human beings have been given the intellect to be able to understand these things, that this is a total contradiction of saying that God is one in three or anything of this nature. So, brother, what I would like to ask you...
Just before you ask your question, just to add something to what you said, and you said it very beautiful and right and correct. The scripture which you quoted was Mark chapter 10, verse 17, where the man came to Jesus. However, Jesus also said in this last gospel, the gospel according to John, which is supposed by our Christian brethren to propagate a doctrine of the divinity of Christ, in John chapter 17, verse 3, there we're told that Jesus said to his disciples just before parting again that this is life eternal, that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent.
Alhamdulillah. Jazakallah khair. We're going to go to our phone call again. We have about 5 minutes before we're going to take our break, but we don't want our viewers to leave. We're going to take a few minutes so we can make some quick changes. But the number here, once again, is 562-1898. You're tuning to Islam in Focus, and our topic of discussion is the Bible, the authentic word of God. Yes, you're on the air.
Hello?
Yes, you're on the air.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
I am an Arabic woman, and I am proud of both of you because you clarify, you know, Islam in right way. This is the first time I'm listening that God sent for all human beings, not just black.
Alhamdulillah.
And I am very, very proud of you. Allah yuwaffiqkum ya Rabbil Alameen.
Alhamdulillah. Jazakallah khair, sister.
Shukran.
Alhamdulillah. We thank the sister for calling in. Once again, the number here is 562-1898, and the phones are lighting up. I know many people are trying to get through, so keep calling. Once again, we're going to go to our phone. Hello, you're on the air. Okay. I'm very sorry. Once again, what the sister was basically saying is that Islam is a way of life for all of humanity. Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, was an Arab. He spoke the Arabic language, but he was a messenger of Almighty God to all of humanity, to black, white, red, brown, yellow, everyone. So Islam is not a religion that is owned by anyone. Islam is the religion of those who adhere to it and those who practice it, regardless of their color or whatever, their ethnic background. Once again, we have a telephone call. Yes, you're on the air.
Yes, I have one more. It speaks in the Quran of the blue-eyed criminal. Could you please clarify that, sir?
Thank you very much. Go ahead, brother. I think
you can take that.
First of all, this verse is not even talking about what's going on in this world. That is talking about the life hereafter. As Muslims, part of our faith is to believe in the life after death. And when Allah mentions this in the book, it says that on that day, people will be blear-eyed with terror, that they will be so scared that their eyes will change color. And he also said that on that day, some people's faces will be black. They will be, you know, in the bad with their Lord, and others will be lit up with white, and they will be in the good. So this has nothing to do with even this world as it exists. That these verses are being misinterpreted by people who are trying to use Islam and misrepresent Islam and this country for their own personal aggrandizement or whatever. As we said, Islam is for all human beings, regardless of their eye color, regardless of their hair texture, whatever. Islam is a way of life of all human beings. And this is our strength in Islam. And people really need to understand. Allah says in Quran very quickly, O mankind, we have created you all from a single pair of a male and a female, and have made you nations and tribes that you may know one another, not despise one another. Surely the most honored of you in the sight of God are those who are most God-fearing. And he also says in the Quran, in the creation of the heavens and the earth, and the variations in your languages and your colors, surely in these are but signs for those who have sense. So read the Quran, those people who are out here who are trying to misuse Islam. The Quran is clear. It is a book that is very clear. So we're going to wind up and we're going to take a few minutes to get some things together. And we don't want our listeners. We have a caller on the phone right now. Please hold the line. We'll be back with Islam in Focus in a few minutes. The number here, 562-1898. You're tuning in to Islam in Focus. And the topic of our discussion today is the Bible the authentic word of God? In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Once again, you're tuned in to Islam in Focus. My name is Saifuddin Hassan, and I have with me also Brother Abdul Malik, Hamza Abdul Malik, and we're talking about, is the Bible the authentic word of God? And we've been talking today about many things in regard to the Bible, but first we're going to go to our telephone call, and then we have a few more questions for our brother Hamza Abdul Malik. Yes, you're on the air.
Yes, how you doing?
Fine, and you?
I'm very unfamiliar with the Quran. The Muslim religion.
religion.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, it's been a bit of an education for me listening to you two fellas. Just want to compliment the both of you.
Thank you.
What I'd like to know is, in Revelation, in the Bible, the book of John, there's two prophets that are supposed to come in the end, in the middle of a, or in the beginning of a seven-year agreement that Israel makes with its enemies. I didn't know if anything in the Quran addressed Revelation in general, or, you know, anything like that. What I wanted to know was your comments on these two prophets, and if you do in fact believe that something like this is to come about. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks for the call. First of all, the book of Revelation, like the book of Ezekiel and the book of Daniel, is highly mythological and allegorical. It's a metaphorical book. It's not to be taken literally. And it's open to various interpretations. So therefore, one cannot pin down any exact definition or defining of anything basically that is said there in those books, except where the meaning is very basic and clear. And as to prophets coming, the door of Christianity was left open for prophets to come. However, we spoke about John chapter 16, verses 12, 13, and 14, where Jesus prophesied the final prophet that would come, and this is the prophet that you and I and everyone else should be looking to find and to adhere to. That prophet has been referred to as He, the Spirit of Truth. Now, many of our Christian brethren have misinterpreted this scripture here, which is termed this person as concept of the paraclete or the comforter. Jesus says, I will pray the Father, and He will give you another comforter in John chapter 14. And so our Christian brethren have assumed that this comforter that would comfort them and guide them was the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost who descended on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, verse 4. However, they have misunderstood this prophecy, and this prophecy has nothing to do with the Pentecost. As a matter of fact, John the Revelator, the writer, has no knowledge of the day of Pentecost at all. That prophecy was propagated by Luke, and Luke answered the call to that prophecy in Luke chapter 24, verse 49. He says, "Tarry ye and wait until you be endued with power from on high," and that happened in his extension of his gospel in Acts chapter 2, verse 4. 60, 70, 80, 90 years later, John came and made his prophecy about He, the Spirit of Truth. And there was no day of Pentecost because in John chapter 20, Jesus was reported to have told his disciples there, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost." Jesus was standing there and he said to them, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost." So it was not a day of Pentecost to receive the Holy Ghost. And that Spirit of Truth was a person who had to hear things and repeat things that came from God. We said that that was the prophet of Islam who brought the Quran, Muhammad, the religion of Islam.
Alhamdulillah. I thought we had a telephone call, but we don't. Just to add something quickly to what the brother has said, that we have to understand and maybe look into these things a little further, because as the brother has said, that many Christians misinterpret this particular verse to mean a spirit or someone, you know, in spirit that's going to come to inspire them or whatever. But is this actually talking about a human being, another person who would come? And there are many other verses, even in the Bible, that talk about the coming of Muhammad in Deuteronomy 18:18. And is there going to be a prophet who will come? That they came to Jesus. The Jews knew that there were going to be a prophet coming. And even many of them had migrated to Medina. They had migrated because they knew there was going to be a prophet coming in that area. And by the grace of God, many of them accepted him. Many of them rejected him. However, there are many verses in the Bible that talk about another prophet coming. One will come upon a camel. The other will come upon an ass. So they knew, and they asked Jesus, "Are you that prophet?" You know, so many verses from the Bible talk about this, and maybe the brother can elaborate a little bit more on this than I can. So if you could, brother, I'd appreciate it.
That's the concept of another prophet. You see, Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray to the Father that he will give you another comforter." Mm-hmm. Now, we have to understand not the English term another, but the Greek word another. Mm-hmm. The Greek word another is allos, allos. The Greek word for another means another of the same kind like Jesus. Had Jesus meant the Holy Ghost or the Holy Spirit, he would have used the word heteros, where you get the word heterosexual form. from a meaning another of a different kind. So that therefore Jesus was in fact prophesying another one who would come like him, who would guide man to all truth. And don't forget that what is truth? Truth is embodied in the Word of God. We have to have the Word of God to know what truth is. And what in fact is the religion of these prophets and the religion of mankind? We know that Jesus himself, peace be upon him, was not a Christian. He had never heard that term Christian used. Christianity and Christian, the term Christ and so forth, was used sometime after the time of Jesus in a place called Antioch. Jesus' religion was what he had said in Mark chapter 3. When his mother, we were told that his mother and his brothers had came looking for him, and someone said, your mother and your brother are outside looking for you outside the synagogue. And Jesus looked around at his companions and he said, who is my mother and who is my brother? Behold, my brother and my mother and my brethren. For whosoever shall do the will of God, the same as my brother, whoever that is, doing the will of God. And that is, in fact, the term Islam, submission to the will of God, Muslim. And James, the writer of the epistle James, said in James, this book, he says, submit yourselves to God and work against the devil. Mm-hmm. So we say that this term means to be Muslim, and that all of the prophets were Muslim. Moses was not a Jew, did not practice Judaism. Mm-hmm. And any religion from God, first of all, cannot be named by the practitioners. It has to be named by God. And Islam is the only religion in the world that has been named by God and its practitioners named by God.
Alhamdulillah. We have another telephone call. Yes, you're on the air.
Yes. My question is for the gentleman, Mr. Malik. You spoke of the second coming Jesus. Jesus speaking about that they will not go through the land until carried out his mission before he has come back again. My question to you is that seeing that Jesus is said in the Bible that Jesus spoke in parables, could this verse that you interpreted be misinterpreted and mean that Jesus' second coming, which they say that Christians and Muslims alike are waiting for?
Okay, thank you very much. This is a very interesting question. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Jesus had prophesied to his disciples that he would return, that he would come again. And prior to that, this is nothing new in biblical theology. Prior to that, there had been prophecies about Elijah, Prophet Elijah returning. And we're told in the Hebrew scriptures that Elijah had been taken up, transported to heaven in a chariot of fire in a whirlwind. And that before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, as a sign of the coming of the Messiah, that Elijah would first come. And when Elijah had came, according to the New Testament scriptures, he was not recognized. And in fact, Jesus had pointed him out, according to that theology, that John the Baptist himself was Elijah. So now, what would one say? Would one say that in reference to that, that this was a metaphor, was an allegory, that Jesus was portraying his second coming, or was it something to be actually looked for? Well, this is theology that Christendom has to unravel for themselves, because when a deputation was sent by the Jews to John to ask them, are you the one to come, are you Elijah? He is reported to have said no, when Jesus in fact said he was Elijah. And when you speak about the Islamic concept of the expectation of Jesus, Muslims have this expectation of Jesus to come as a sign of the last hour.
Alhamdulillah. Jazakallah khair. We have another telephone call. Yes, you're on the air.
Yes, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Okay, I want to talk about the comment that the brother made earlier about the African Americans receiving a guide. And mm-hmm. the brother said something about there will be no guide for the African Americans. I just like to say that, after the 400 years of slavery that we've been through, the many things that we've been through in this country, that how in the end was we going to receive Islam if Allah did not send us a guide? Okay, I want to know your comments on that. If you said Allah did not send a guide just for the African Americans, I want to know after the persecution and what we've been through in this country, how is we going to receive Islam without a guide, without somebody guiding us to Islam? And I want to ask the brothers there, how many of you, because I know how I came to Islam. I want to ask you, how many of you, how did you come to Islam, and through what did you come to Islam? Through, into indirect or direct?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Now, thanks again. Brother. I think we did touch on that, and we did say, not that the Afro-American people or the African-American people or the blacks of this country or anywhere in the world, that they did not receive a guide. We said, in fact, the guide for all mankind, as the Bible teaches in the Quran, we understand this terminology and this concept that God is no respecter of person. You see, Allah says He's made you in different hues and tribes and so forth, that you may know one another, not that you might despise one another. And surely the best of you are those who are best in their deeds and conduct. So therefore, nationality has nothing to do with God giving guidance to His creature, to His creatures. And so that therefore, we say that Islam was given to the whole of mankind, that the Prophet of Islam was happened to be an Arab by nationality, and that Islam was propagated first there in Arabia. But however, Islam has extended to all corners of the world, and how we became Muslim is the same way you and everyone else became or can become Muslim, and that is adhering to the word of God that is revealed in the Quran and through the guidance of the Prophet of Islam, Muhammad. You can go to any mosque or mosque in the community, any bookstore, and read up on Islam and find this information. Would you like to answer that?
Alhamdulillah. Well, we have another phone call. Maybe after that we can add a little more to that. Yes, you're on the air.
Yes, sir. I'd like to get back to what the brother was speaking on. Mm-hmm. Now, I understand the statement that you made that Muhammad's to all. However, Allah sent the Arab speaking to an Arab. He didn't send an Englishman speaking to an Arab. He sent one of his own tongue. I will raise one up among you. So you cannot say that, I could not understand because he's not of me. Right? That's what it states. So the question is, now, what the sister was asking, who came to us? That's all. And how was you introduced to Islam? And then you never clarified that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. Personally, if you look at the way that, alhamdulillah, that many people are embracing Islam in this society today, you see people of all races and all colors embracing Islam, and this is the beauty of Islam. Me personally, if you want to ask me why I embraced Islam, when I read the autobiography of Malcolm X, it inspired me to embrace Islam. Why? Because the very same reason why I honestly rejected Christianity is the very same reason that you're talking. You know, when I understood, I believed in one creator, and I believe that there's a creator, then it has to be a way of life that brings all of humanity together. And I found that through Islam. And that was the main focal point that got me interested in Islam. So, you know, as we said before, you know, you have to really understand these verses in the context as they will reveal that these verses are not talking about a person who will come to the black man in America. There's nothing in the Quran that deals with any of this. Okay, as you said, yes, Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, came to the people of Arabia. But even in the time of Muhammad, before he died, there were people who were African. Islam was in Africa, in Ethiopia, in Abyssinia, before the revelation was even finished, given to Muhammad. Oh, wow. So Islam was in Africa long before that. And the people of Africa, they don't speak English. They don't speak Arabic. The people in Malaysia is the most, Indonesia, the most populated Muslim country in the world today. They didn't speak Arabic, but they were able to embrace Islam because of the fitrah of Islam. Islam is the nature of all human beings. So if you study the Quran, you will see that you will easily get away from this, because if you read the Quran, and I know most of the people who quote these verses, they don't read the Quran. They read other sources. They read the Bible. They quote from the Bible more than they quote from the Quran. So read the Quran and you won't come to these conclusions. Islam is for all humanity, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Khatam al-Nabiyyin. He was the last of the prophets, the seal of the prophets. He said there will be mubashirat who will come, people who will have inspiration, but they will not be given wahi or revelation from God. There's no more revelation coming. No man, nobody will be given revelation from God. We have another telephone call. Yes, you're on the air.
Okay, I just heard you say something about the introduction into the Muslim religion.
Mm-hmm.
The way you brought it to me was that it's an individual thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's how you feel. But when you become introduced into Christianity, it's only one way to come.
Mm-hmm.
You have to come through baptism.
Mm-hmm.
And it's universal, one way. One way, one faith, one religion.
Mm-hmm.
The way you brought it was like you came your way because of the autobiography of Malcolm X. Now, there should be some type of direction in your book on how you should become a Muslim through that one faith.
Okay, I'm not fully understanding your question. If you could, you know, just...
Okay, I believe in one faith, one religion, one way. And the way you're talking about is that you became a Muslim because the way you felt after you read the autobiography of Malcolm X.
Okay. Is that your question?
That's my question. My question is that the way you became a Muslim, it's nothing divine in the way that you became a Muslim.
Okay.
Because you became a Muslim through a book.
Okay, that's not exactly what I'm saying. I think you kind of misunderstood. Now, I'm not going to tell you everything that you know, inspired me to become Muslim, but I'm saying this is one of the things that attracted me to Islam. But it's Allah's will. He guides whom he wills.
Okay, but see, okay, if you're going to talk to someone about, there's something, it should be something divine. Now, when I'm hearing that you saying that you became a Muslim behind a book, that's not divine. When you become a Christian, you become a Christian through baptism, and that's scriptural. You can read about in the Bible. There's one way to become a Christian.
Okay.
I'm not talking about any man-made religion. I'm not talking about becoming a Baptist or Methodist, because you can't read about that in the scriptures. Read about being a Christian in the scriptures.
Okay. Well, I think you totally misunderstood what I said. I said that was what attracted me to Islam, to become a Muslim. That is not how you become a Muslim. To become a Muslim, all you have to do is bear witness that there is one God, Allah. La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. Okay? And that Allah, you know, Allah is one, and that Muhammad is the seal of the prophets. Okay. This is what you do to embrace Islam. I just expressed what attracted me because one of our callers had asked me this particular question. But I think maybe the brother can deal with this question a little better than I can. So just, we'd like to thank you. Please, we'd like to hang up so we can get to our other phone call.
Okay, I'm a member of the Church of Christ.
Okay. I think he's going to address your question. Thank
okay,
you very much.
Okay, I was to hang on the phone or...
No, if you could hang up, you want to call back, but we have some other
back,
people
I'm
that would like to
out.
Try to call. Thank you very much, sir.
We're told in the Quran, La ikrah fi deen, that there's no compulsion in religion. In other words, when it comes to matters of God and worship and belief in God, there's no compelling a person to do it. Why? Because the truth stands out clear from error. In other words, we have an intellect, and we are to use our intellect to make a choice to accept or reject the will of God. So when the brother speaks about having read something and used his intellect, evidently this is the way he found his way into the truth, finally. We remember that Jesus, when we quoted to you before, the brother who was just on the line, specifically addressing this to him, that when the man came to Jesus, the young rich man, and he asked him, "What must I do to have eternal life? I want to be saved." And Jesus didn't say anything to him about being baptized or believing in him or the Trinity or anything of that nature. To be saved, Jesus addressed that man. He told him what not to do. First of all, why callest thou me good? There's none good but God. Get that straight. Now, about your question, he said, you know the commandments. Do not steal, do not kill, do not commit adultery, fornication, these things. If you follow the law that was given to Moses, you will be saved. And Jesus finally said in Matthew 7:21 and 22 and 23 that many people would come to him on that day of judgment, boasting, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name do many good works, and so forth. And he said, he will confess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Now, iniquity means lawlessness, ye who do not have the law, who did not follow the law, and as a result of that, you were sinning. And Christianity is the only religion that I know of that has no law. So he says, you that work iniquity, that you that didn't have law, because Paul said that law was a curse and that salvation is the rule. And Jesus said, till heaven and earth in Matthew 5:17 pass away, not one jot or tittle of the law shall fail, till all fulfilled.
So, and I wish we had time to even deal with Paul, because as you said, he was the one that said, you know, where there's no law, there's no transgression.
Right,
so
right.
He abolished it,
exactly.
But this is not what Jesus said.
Exactly.
Hello, you're on the air.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
Alhamdulillah, I appreciate you all's program today. It's clarifying a lot for me, but I would like to make a comment, and maybe you could extend the comment as to the callers there, either from the Elijah Muhammad or Solomon's movement. About how did you accept Islam? And if they studied their history, we would know that Islam was around way before Elijah Muhammad, and the first masjid was established, I believe it was in Iowa, in 1925. So we know that Islam and Muslims were here in America much more longer before Elijah even got started, as well as their Arabic writings in the caves of Arizona and the teachings of the African slaves who were here who taught Islam hundreds of years before Elijah Muhammad and the whole Farrakhan, Elijah Muhammad's movement. So Islam was here, and I would say it's divine that as an American, with those scriptures there, that I today can go into the scripture of Arabic and begin to read it and understand it. So there is some sort of God giving us the ability to do this and not claiming one individual as Elijah Muhammad, whom we know had a seventh or ninth grade education and didn't go into the scriptures himself. So, and he only spoke English. So, you know, this is a definite clarification that we didn't become Muslims because of Elijah Muhammad as Afro-Americans, Europeans, or any other nation, as the brothers have said. Now, if you like, you can elaborate more on the history of Islam in America, or whatever the case may be. But Islam was here, and it was being taught and practiced in its original form before Elijah Muhammad was born. Mm-hmm. Salaam alaikum rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum salaam rahmatullah.
Well, not much to say about that, but speaking about Elijah Muhammad and Farrakhan and his activities and so forth, many people admire the works of the Nation of Islam, and they are some things that should be admired. However, when we talk about economics and social issues, that's one thing, and many people can speak very glowing words and have a very charismatic deliverance about these kind of things. But when we talk about theology, things of the spirit world, or things of a scripture, then we have to talk about something that we have facts about, we have to speak from knowledge, we have to speak from a sound source. And unfortunately, the Nation of Islam, with Elijah Muhammad, its founder or co-founder, whatever, and Minister Farrakhan, they are devoid of theological soundness. The theology that they teach is not sound, if you claim that it's Islam. If you claim that it's its own Nation of Islam with its own theology, then that's no more than what Jim Jones taught, or David Koresh taught, or any of these people who could speak well and had an organization or following taught. But the theology is wrong, and the theology that we talk about is the theology that has been propagated by Islam over 1,400 years, and that's the theology that is Islamic theology.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you. We have time for maybe one more call, but keep trying to call. We may try to get it in. Thank you. You're on the air.
Good evening. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Allahu Akbar. My brothers, I appreciate the program that you are airing today, and I can only commend you and your organization, as well as the Honorable Minister Farrakhan, with his followers and the divine leadership that they are encompassing in this part of the earth. And for us to understand that we came here from Africa as Muslims, and for anybody to call in and say that Christianity is the religion that they aspire to is ludicrous. If they go back in the history, and when we were punished for reading any literature that would place us in our as to our where we came from and our heritages and religions, the Bible was given to us, and today it's a free book. We can go to hotels or any other public place and grasp this book, and the confines of that book totally upsets me when that book have no positive role model for us as a black nation. And your work, I find it to be outstanding and appalling, and is worthy of praise.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you very much.
Allah.
Alhamdulillah. We have a few minutes left on our show today. I'd like to get Brother Hamza Abdul Malik. Maybe we can try to get in this one call, and we'd like to have him just give some closing remarks, and then we're going to close out our telephone lines and our show for today. We're going to go to this one last call. Okay, no call. I'm very sorry. Brother Hamza Abdul Malik, I'd just like for you to maybe give some closing remarks in regard to our topic of discussion today, and then we're going to try to finalize our program on that note.
As regard to our topic today, the authenticity of the Bible, is it the Word of God unadulterated? I think we have shown some evidence, and we could have gone much more intensive to show that it's not, that it doesn't stand the test. However, we didn't have a chance to present to you an argument today, and perhaps we will do a show on the authenticity of the Quran, and someone will be able to come and present those matters from the Quran, and someone perhaps would come and challenge that, was open to do that. However, we finally say that the Bible is not the Word of God, unadulterated, and that the Quran is, in fact, the Word of God, unadulterated, and that it has now abrogated, replaced the Bible for guidance for all of mankind, that the Prophet of Islam has come to bring the final revelation from God to all of mankind, that all prophets prior to Muhammad were national prophets, came only to their own people. Muhammad has been designated and commissioned as a prophet to the whole of mankind, and the religion of Islam, meaning total submission to the will of God, is the religion for all of mankind. It's the natural religion of mankind. And we invite you, our viewing audiences, to investigate the religion of Islam, to look into the Quran, to investigate the life of this prophet of Islam. We disrespect none of the prophets. We hold them in high regard, and we see that they had benefit and that they were models for their communities, and the scripture that they had brought intact was for their communities. However, today, the final revelation from God is the Quran, and we invite you to come and investigate Islam as the religion of mankind, and perhaps you will find your salvation and peace of mind there.
Jazakallah khair, brother, for coming today. What we would like to do to give you an address of our masjid in New Haven, Masjid al-Islam, 624 George Street, directly behind St. Raphael's Hospital. The number there is 777-8004. We would like to thank all of you for listening, and we hope that this was beneficial to you. We would like to send you all off with a salutation of peace. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. Thank you.